Well, good morning and aloha.
Aloha.
I love that about Hawaii. We could always do that. I want to welcome you all to the 50th anniversary celebration of Saints Constantine and Helen Greek Orthodox Church, and today especially this special banquet in this amazingly beautiful place in Nu'uanu Valley. Truly, we are blessed to be in everyone's presence, in God's presence, and certainly in the presence of nature. The first thing we'd like to start out with before we begin, before we have the prayer, is we want to recognize, we have many honored guests that are with us for today, and Father Alex will be giving each of them a lay. So if we can all be prepared for this. And of course, our first lay recipient is His Grace Apostolos of Medea. Please give a hand. Another flower lay. All right, thank you. Our next honored guest is Father Chijikos and Prepetita Elaine. Two lays are better than one, there we go. We're so appreciative that making the trip to come and visit us and celebrate this wonderful time. Ted says, tell everyone that Father Chijikos was our first civilian priest. So noted. Thank you, Ted. So noted. Next is Presbyterita Eli Dojas. Thank you, Eli, for coming. We so appreciate it. And finally, the Moscos family, Harry and Vicky Moscos, their son, daughter-in-law, and grandchildren. Lots of lays there, Father. Maybe he needs a lovely assistant to help him put those lays on. That might be a good thing. Very good. This only happens once every 50 years, so it's a wonderful... It's a worthy occasion. Right. And the children get some too, absolutely. Everybody gets a lei, right? Come to Hawaii, you get a lei. Absolutely. Even the baby gets a lei, all right. Yeah. All right, very good. Thank you, Father. One final thing before we begin our prayer is we want to thank, there are so many people to thank. We have some special thanks here for the Oahu Country Club General Manager to help us with this beautiful place and their staff. Mr. Butch Bukes, who helped us and make the arrangements for this wonderful and beautiful place. Also, I have to thank from many levels Tina Dimitrian, who was the chair of the banquet, who put this whole thing together. How about a hand for Tina? I have to tell you, when we first walked in, I walked in and said, we should move the tables over here and move the thing over there and move this over there. And everyone just did it. And Tina had to walk in and I screwed up her whole morning. So she came in and she recovered the whole thing. So thank you, Tina. You did such a great job. Superb. It's all my fault, but you did great. And finally, the Philoptikos, who put together these beautiful table settings. These were specially grown orchids for this event. So thank you to the Philoptikos. And now, if we could, I would like to ask for our clergy to lead us in prayer. Perhaps you'd like to come forward and do it that way? How would you like to do it, Father? Okay? Okay. So I'd like to ask the clergy to come up and lead us all in prayer.
Good morning, everyone. Aloha.
Aloha.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever and to the ages of ages. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, despota ευλόγησον.
Χριστέ ο Θεός ημών, ευλόγησον την πόση και την βρόση των δούλων Σου, ότι Άγιος η πάντοτε νυν και αεί και εις τους αιώνας των αιώνων. Αμήν. Christ our God, bless the food and the drink that we are going to partake, and bless us all as we've been celebrating this wonderful occasion and milestone of the 50th anniversary of the Blessed Community in St. Constantine and Helen in Hawaii, Honolulu, and give us your blessing to sustain our life in peace, love, and concord now and forever, and unto the ages of ages. Amen. Καλημέρα, χρόνια πολλά, καλή όρεξη, enjoy, bon appetit, and the program is going to be blessed to see all of you, to be happy and enjoy this wonderful event. God bless you all.
If I could please have your attention, please. We'd like to continue our program. And so first we're going to have Father Alexander give a speech. Please. Please help me in welcoming Father Alexander.
Thank you. Your Grace, Bishop Apostolos, Amidia, dear Reverend Fathers, Brother Clergy, Presbyteras, honored founders and guests, and my dear spiritual Ohana family. I'm very honored to stand before you in the your presence as we celebrate this grand golden anniversary of our parish on the island of Oahu and on the Hawaiian Islands. Yesterday, we had a wonderful celebration. We had the International Lenten Potluck, which acknowledged our diversity as a parish on the islands. And it was a great testimony to this fact. And we also alluded to the fact that we are the most remote island in the United States and all the nations. I think God has a good sense of humor sometimes. Sometimes I get these little things that happen to me at the strangest moments, where allergy attack. And so if I sneeze, please forgive me, but I know that our loving God has a great sense of humor. I've experienced that throughout my life, and sometimes it happens at the most peculiar moments. So if I do sneeze, forgive me. But of course, I welcome all of you here on our second day of celebrations. We celebrate the most glorious 50 years of history of our parish on Oahu. And I'd like to acknowledge all the priests who have served throughout its history, 50-year history here, including the chaplains that came here, the many chaplains that came through and celebrated services in the beginning, and when you celebrated at the Episcopal Church. And how honored we are to have with us our first assigned priest as a civilian, Father Dean Jijikos and Presbyter Elaine Jijikos, as our first clergy family to be here. And what an honor, and you are amazing. And when I think about how this started here, it's an honor to get to know you and acquainted with you in person. I've known a number of our clergy who have served here. And I hope I don't miss any names, but I'd like to acknowledge all the clergy that have served here. Father Dean Jijikos from 1968 to 1970. And I do remember Father Fotios Mendikis, who served here in 1972. When I was in the Church of San Jose, California, St. Nicholas, Father Fotios became our assistant priest at the age of 62,
And I have gotten to know him. He would be at our home. And the term I always remember him telling me is Crisopedi, golden child. And he would say that to all the children, but that was very endearing for me. And the way he would come to our family and tell about his days in the seminary and share stories about that would lighten up our hearts and make us laugh. And so he has a special place in my heart. And then followed by Father Michael Reimer. He preceded me at my first assignment in San Jose. He was an assistant there. But way before that, he was your priest. And I've known him to be a great speaker, very gifted and talented speaker. And he was one of the tops for that. Of course, Father Peter Salmas, who helped make the cathedral a possibility on Honolulu Street, having moved from Old Pali to Honolulu with the help of great benefactor, Mr. and Mrs. William Jagodis. And I'm going to read a letter from him after I acknowledge all the priests. He was my neighbor in San Jose in Belmont, California, Holy Cross in Belmont. So I've known him over the years as a neighbor and a great person to go to for advice. George Petitis, I remember him as an upperclassman, very kind man. Father Cyril Loeb, of blessed memory. He was known to be the eldest, the most senior of the seminarians when I was at the school. So we had a great respect, a Jewish lawyer, very strong, deliberate, and a father figure for a lot of us there at the seminary. Let's see, we have Father George Bessinas and his Presbyteria Crisanti. They have a special place in my heart too. We had a lot of classes together, Father George and I. And I remember when he met his Presbyteria Crisanti at seminary, and I said, this is something special. Love at first sight, and very cute couple, very instrumental and dynamic with the youth. I knew that Presbyteria Crisanti is a powerhouse there. And Father George, very calm and very good with the kids. I remember that. Father Dean Kodukis, classmate of mine, Presbyteria Valley. And his very kind, good man. Excuse me. Oh, thank you. And his famous phrase is this, don't worry. He said that as a seminarian. He probably said this here a lot at the parish. And good friend, wonderful classmate. And I acknowledge also Father Nicholas Gambas. He's probably one of them that I really didn't get to know, but I've heard about him. But and I heard he was very dynamic and a great leader, but I didn't get to know him, but I acknowledge him too. His Grace Bishop Anthimos of Olympus, a blessed memory, who served there for a short time. And I remember him as a young man when I was serving as an altar boy at Clergy Lady, 1982, San Francisco. He impressed me as a very dynamic young bishop. And when I became a priest, he was very straightforward when he'd correct me. He said, I remember what he said, don't say, take, ye eat, this is my body, which is given for you for the forgiveness of sins. He said, remission. And he cleared that up. He was very direct,
And what I appreciated that, his wisdom and his straightforwardness as a great liturgist. I remember him as a great liturgist. And so he always impressed me. Father Demetrius Dogis, a blessed memory. When my family moved to Sacramento area in 1987, I grew up in San Jose. I was still in seminary. I would go in the choir. I have great memories of those times. And I remember, I said this last night too, being asked as a seminarian to chant at Annunciation Sacramento. And when I experienced that Holy Week with Father Demetrius Dogis, his love for the services, his spiritual strength where he could connect body and soul, he had this something special there. And when he would, especially Monday evening when he do the gospel reading, "Woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, you hypocrites!" I remember that. I go, wow. I go, that's as if Christ is speaking to me. Oh my goodness. And when he do the Nasto Theos on Saturday morning, outstanding, and power of the resurrection. I never forget that those things impress a young seminarian, young person, and that remains with me. Father John Angelis, who filled in at one time, my senior respected elder, gentle, kind, and always a kind word to say and good advice for me as a priest, too. And we had my last predecessor, Father John Coonley. He was an upperclassman and a gifted teacher. As I remember, he was very gifted at in teaching, and he was able to draw crowds for the adult religious education, as I heard. Very gifted there. And I'm blessed to have in our midst Father John Calanzis, Presbyteria Michelle, and their two younger sons, George and James, and I've got to meet Evangelos as well. They are a great blessing to have at our parish. They help in so many ways. Father John, we alternate giving the sermons. Presbyteria, she's joined our choir and helps with her voice, her music talents, and her sons to serve in the altar and to also help with the youth programs, the Sunday school and dance and everything. So I'm very grateful for your presence here. It's you're a godsend. Father Jonathan Netanyahu, who somehow ended up in our presence from Moldavia, and you surprised me with your magnificent operatic voice when we first came, and we wished you as you work in your ministry much success, and hope that you pray that you find a parish, because I feel that your gifts are meant for a parish that would, and a spiritual flock. And it's wonderful to have you here as well with us. And please forgive me if I missed any of our priests that have served our parish. I must have forgotten at least one, maybe, but forgive me if I did. I am going to share with you a letter from Father Peter Salmas. I got a call from him last night, and he offered a letter, and so I printed out this morning. And he's very beloved here in Hawaii. And I'd like to share that before I go on with the rest of my speech. It goes as follows. Your Grace, Bishop Apostolos, Father Alexander, Presbyter Nicole, and our dear friends, the stewards of Saints Constantine and Helen, As you gather now to celebrate the 50 years of our beloved Orthodox faith in these islands of Hawaii, I rejoice with you in thought and prayer, though I am saddened by the reality that it is not possible to be with you today. It is difficult to be concise in conveying this message of loving congratulations to you. Simply put, our years together were truly blessed and really very exciting. Those 6 years were historic in many ways as we grew and moved from a small, very lovely, but way too small house in Nu'u'anu to a church site that sits at the base of Punch Bowl, overlooks Honolulu and Waikiki, and is visible as a witness of our faith to all who travel on H1. Throughout these 50 years, the guiding hand of our Lord Jesus Christ has been evident. From the encouragement of Archbishop Iakovos to the faithful and diligent struggles of founding families, to Metropolitan Anthony and the hopeful ways remembered generosity of Bill and Jean Chagotis. And because of the desire of many stewards whose time and talents were used to the glory of God, you stand now as a beacon of light in the Pacific. I pray that you never forget your roots and that you seek only to nurture the sacrificial efforts of the faithful who struggled and persevered to establish our Holy Greek Orthodox heritage in Hawaii. We are all recipients of their faith, their courage, their fortitude, and their love. Our family, Presbyterian Nikki, Constantine, and Cara Maria, and I will be forever grateful for the years which made us part of your family, even to the present day. May your patron saints, Constantine and Helen, continue to prayerfully guide you to keep as your perpetual hope and steadfast goal the Holy Cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through the intercessions of the Theotokos and of all the saints, may you continue to give glory to his holy name. With love in Christ, I remain faithfully yours, Father Peter. Beautiful letter. Now going on, I'd like to send out much gratitude to all of our founders, those who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and hope of of eternal life. And I mention them each, and if I miss them, please forgive me too, because we haven't finished our year yet, but it's been an honor to read about all of our founders and get to know them who have gone on to rest in eternal life. And these are Tom and Catherine Sophos, Konstantinos and Catherine Roumanis, Dimitrios and Julia Anastasopoulos, James and Aphrodite Kronis, John Roumanis, Harry and Victoria Moskos, Peter and Fanny Proskephalos, Gus and Catherine Pappas. May their memory be eternal. And to all our surviving founders, Ted Anagiros Anastasopoulos, Helen Anastasopoulos Potts, Harry and Vicky Moskos, who are here with us. And it's great to meet you in person too as our founders. And your faith is very inspiring. I thank you for your deep and profound faith in establishing this parish here on Oahu. Well done, good and faithful servants, those who have fallen asleep in the Lord and those who are still with us. To all our benefactors who've made our parish possible too, and their generosity, great thank you to William and Evgenia Chagotis, Pauline, Peter, and Mark Van Dorn, George Van Vulis, Renal Constantino, and we simply recognize their awesome, great generosity. May the legacy of our founders and benefactors live on. May Orthodoxy thrive and continue on the Hawaiian Islands for the next 50 years and beyond. May we all get to know the love and mercy of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to also acknowledge our committee who made this 50th anniversary program possible, especially our chairperson, Mrs. Regina Mass, who's done incredible planning and of everything here, as well as our council has supported, and also Mrs. Tina Dimitrio, and for organizing a lot of the RSVPs and everything. And I simply say aloha and thank you. And it's wonderful to have your grace and our presence to represent the Holy Metropolis of San Francisco and His Eminence, Metropolitan Hierosimos. And with this, I close. Thank you very much. Makalo.
Thank you, Father. You know, as we all know, things don't happen by themselves. They take work, they take effort, dedication, and even more so with things like this. So I think we all have a great debt of gratitude for our next speaker, who is the chairman of the 50th anniversary. She's worked incredibly hard and with amazing leadership, and has brought things like we see here today. So please join me in welcoming our 50th anniversary chairwoman, Miss Regina Mass. Mrs. Regina Mass.
Your Grace, Bishop Apostolos of Medea, Reverend Fathers, Presbyteras, Founders, and all my fellow parishioners and friends of the church. We have some wonderful friends here today. We also have many visitors who have traveled a long way, and we're so grateful that you made the effort to come to join us for this very special celebration. These beautiful Hawaiian islands were discovered by Polynesian seafarers who set sail from the Marquesas and Society Islands below the equator. By 900 AD, they had settled here, and they had become the Hawaiian people. The first recorded European discoverer of the Hawaiian Islands was Captain James Cook in 1778, sailing for England. We know that Captain Cook conducted religious services, prayer services, for his sailors aboard his ship. He also officiated at a funeral. Two years later, the Kingdom of Hawaii had enacted a trade agreement with Russia, and a Russian fort was built on the island of Kauai around 1800. A Russian Orthodox priest celebrated the Divine Liturgy in 1804 on a ship adjacent to the fort. This was probably the first Orthodox service in the Hawaiian Islands. That little spark of light became a beacon of light over time. The liturgy was a mere 26 years after Captain Cook's first religious services. This divine liturgy occurred 16 years before the first Protestant missionaries came to Hawaii. It occurred 38 years before the first Mormon missionaries came to Hawaii. We can only wonder how differently the fate of the Hawaiian people would have been had they received Christianity through Orthodoxy. When we think of the history of the Orthodox of Hawaii, we know that there were many Greek and Russian sailors passing through these islands on many of the whalers and merchant ships which called at the port towns in Hawaii. We know that by the late 1880s, Uncle George Lycurgus had settled on the big island of Hawaii, and he was certainly a well-known and colorful individual. He invited many young men from his village in Sparta to come to the big island to work. Several young men came at his invitation, including Dimitri Anastasopoulos, also known as Jimmy, James Cronus and his brother George, Costas Romanus and his brother John. These young men were hard workers and made a good life for themselves on the big island and later in Honolulu. James Anastasopoulos returned to Greece to find a bride. He married Julia and brought her back to Hawaii. Costas Romanus returned to Greece and married Catherine Romanus and brought her to Hawaii. James Cronos married Aphrodite and brought her to Hawaii. John Romanus did not marry. George Cronus married a local woman of Portuguese descent and had three sons. I've often thought about those three first immigrant women and what a difficult life they must have had. Can you imagine planning a trip halfway around the world where you knew you were going to go live among people who did not speak a language you could speak? They were alone. They had the three of them. They were basically alone. And they had to rely on each other. They had to learn English, and they became wonderful pillars of our community. These three women were very pious, and they did not have a church here in Hawaii. And the church, of course, was so central to their lives. They had carried with them icons and holy water from Greece, but there was no priest. And they must have wondered what was going to happen when they had children. Who was going to baptize their babies? What about marriages when their children grew up? Who was going to perform the marriage? When they died, who was going to perform the funeral? It must have been a scary future that they faced, but they came. And we read in the biographies that Julia's father went to the Metropolitan of Athens and asked, what should they do since there was no priest to baptize Julia's new baby, Helen? The Metropolitan told Julia's father to take the baby to the Church of England and have the baby baptized. And Helen was baptized in the Church of England. And later, when she went to college in California, she was chrismated and entered the Orthodox Church. James and Aphrodite waited. Their little baby Catherine had been born, and there was no one to baptize Catherine. They waited until a visiting priest passing from between Australia and the United States stopped for a few days, and he baptized the baby. We've learned the story of Tom Sophos, a Greek-American who had graduated from the Naval Academy in Annapolis and had served and was wounded in World War II. When he was discharged, he decided to stay in Hawaii, and he became a well-known developer. One day he heard that there was a new Greek-American woman in town. She was working at Pearl Harbor, and he made a point of meeting her, and they had their first date on Valentine's Day. And they got married 90 days later, but there was no Greek Orthodox priest to perform the ceremony. So they wound up having a civil marriage, and after many months took a trip to the mainland to visit Tom's family in Annapolis, and I believe Baltimore, and they were married at that time. When Tom and Catherine, whom we also called Rena, would go to the mainland, they would make a point of visiting Tom's fellow classmates who had stayed in the Navy and had worked their way up the ladder, and they would ask them, please get a naval chaplain or another military chaplain assigned to Hawaii. We need an Orthodox priest. In 1942, following the bombing of Pearl Harbor, there was massive destruction here, and many laborers were sent in to help clean up the mess. And one of the young men that was sent to Hawaii was Peter Proskephalos, another of our founders. Peter worked with the cleanup of the bombing of Pearl Harbor, and then he stayed in government service and worked for the Department of Transportation for the Navy. One of the stories I remember him telling, which I thought was delightful, was he arranged a bus tour for sailors to go see Babe Ruth play baseball. He was playing here in Honolulu, and Pete arranged this tour, and I thought, boy, that must have been pretty memorable for all those young sailors. Anyway, Pete went back after the war, and he married his childhood friend, Fanny Proskephalos, and brought her back to Hawaii. They remained in Hawaii for the rest of their lives and became pillars of this church. In 1961, Father Nick Karras was assigned to the military sea transport ship Sultan, and when in port, he arranged for services for the ship, on the ship, or at Hickam, or at a chapel at St. Andrew's Episcopal Cathedral. Military and civilian Orthodox were all invited to participate. Between 1963 and 65, there were weekly lay services. If a visiting priest or chaplain was in Hawaii, he would come and officiate. In 1963, our founders, Harry and Vicky Moscos, moved here from Albuquerque. Harry had been appointed bureau chief for the Associated Press, a most prestigious position. They were quite surprised when they moved here to discover there was no church. And in fact, Hawaii was the only state in the Union without an Orthodox church. They became involved with the Orthodox community. And with the birth of their two daughters, there was even more emphasis on obtaining that church. Many years later, they moved to El Paso, Texas, and they discovered that El Paso had no church. By the time they left El Paso, there was a church. They had already learned how to do this. Other new arrivals in 1963 included our founders, Gus and Kate Pappas. They must have been shocked when they arrived at Hickam Air Force Base with three young children and no church. They contacted other Orthodox families and were very active with the community. These two spent a lifetime working for an incredible number of charities. If you check their obituaries, you will be amazed at what they accomplished in their life. But Kate, in an interview, said her husband Gus felt his greatest achievement was helping to establish Saints Constantine and Helen. In 1964, the Orthodox community pooled resources and paid to bring a priest, Father Peter Palum, to Hawaii for the Holy Week services. This was the first time Holy Week services were celebrated in Hawaii. We can imagine how moved the Orthodox were to participate in these holy services leading up to the resurrection service. On Monday following Easter, Julia and James Anastasopoulos had a gathering at their home. James expressed his gratitude to Father Palum for the beautiful services. He told Father Palum, and I'm quoting, "It was as if you opened the curtain and I saw paradise." That night, James Anastasopoulos fell asleep in the Lord. In 1965, Archbishop Iacobo celebrated the Divine Liturgy, after which the Orthodox faithful made a commitment to establish the church. The founders are, in alphabetical order, James and Julia Anastasopoulos, Ted and Helen Anastasopoulos, James and Aphrodite Cronus, Harry and Vicky Moskos, Gus and Kate Pappas, Peter and Fanny Proskephalos, Kostas and Catherine Romanis, Thomas and Catherine Sophos. In 1965, the Eastern Orthodox community received the Charter of Incorporation from the state of Hawaii. In 1966, Air Force Military Chaplain William Stroyahan was assigned to service, and he provided religious services for the military and civilians. During this time, a strong, permanent congregation developed. In 1968, the first civilian priest was assigned to Hawaii, and that, of course, is Father Dean Jijikos and Presbytera Elaine. We're so pleased to have you here with us today. The Divine Liturgy was conducted at Epiphany Episcopal Church every Sunday. We have been fortunate to have such good relationship with the Episcopal Church in Hawaii, as they have provided many churches in which to worship. The Catholic Church also has helped us. For many years, the priest would go to Kauai and would hold services in the Catholic Church there. And I believe Father has held church services at St. Teresa's in Maui. In addition to the founders, there were others who contributed significantly in making this church a reality, including Serge and Anna Dankovich and Stephen Polanski. After using the Epiphany Church for a few years, the congregation decided to buy a building and convert it to a church. Parishioners identified a property at 17 Old Pali Place. Bank of Hawaii was approached for a mortgage. Bank of Hawaii said they would give us a mortgage as long as 10 parishioners signed for the mortgage. That's a lot of people signing. Finally, the congregation was able to talk Bank of Hawaii into agreeing to have 4 people sign. We're very happy to have 2 of our signers here today, Ted Anastasopoulos and Michael Mikalidis and his wife Eleni sitting over here. For all of us, most of us moved to Hawaii after the church at Opali was established or converted to Orthodoxy after that church was established. For all of us, it was a relief to have a church in place, to be able to go and worship at the church, to have a priest to console and guide us, to have a priest to perform marriages, baptisms, and funerals. We owe a great deal of gratitude to those who made this possible. I'll now read the names of our founders once again, and at this time I ask the founders, if they are able, and their families to please rise. We have many amongst us. James and Julia Anastasopoulos, Ted and Helen, and their descendants. If you would please rise, or at least raise your hand. Thank you. And a lot of you see Coralie Vallis and Thalia Tui. They are part of that family. Nikki and Vicky, Harry and Vicky Moscos. Thank you. James and Aphrodite Cronus and their descendants. Peter and Fanny Proskephalos. Costas and Catherine Romanus. Their dear niece, Georgia, is here. They love Georgia like a daughter. Thomas and Catherine Sophos. In addition to the generous founders and supporters of our church, we have four benefactors and families who have passed away but will not be forgotten by the members of this church. We owe a great deal to William and Evgenia Chergotis. William was a successful architect from New Jersey, and he was a devoted Orthodox servant to the church. He made many visits to Hawaii and met many of the early pioneering families to Hawaii, and they would discuss establishing a church. He met with Archbishop Iakovos, and he agreed to assist with financing a church. He wound up pledging $500,000. Originally, we were going to remodel the old church and expand it. As many of you will recall, half the congregation sat inside. Half the congregation stood outside and listened through the doors and windows. It was such a tiny facility as our church group. We were going to expand that, but then the opportunity to purchase our current church became available. And Mr. Chigotis again agreed that he would be willing to finance the church up to $500,000. Other funds were raised, but we were still approximately $50,000 short. Mr. Chigotis paid that difference and made it possible for us to proceed with the purchase of this church. All of that was a great gift, but he did so much more. He commissioned Mr. Tonelli to build the iconostasion. He commissioned Mr. Tonelli to make the stained glass windows and the icons that decorate and beautify our church. May their memories be eternal. The second family was Peter and Pauline Van Doren and their son, Mark. Peter was the general manager for several hotels and restaurants in Hawaii, including the Outrigger Club. Pauline was the church organist. She sang in the choir. The choir was her great passion. And they had one son, Mark. They moved to Las Vegas, where Peter was managing a hotel. Mark was killed in a traffic accident. He was about 21 years old. They brought their son back to Hawaii and had him buried here. And when Peter finally retired, Pauline and Peter returned to Hawaii, and they lived to the end of their lives here. Peter unfortunately developed Alzheimer's. Pauline was his devoted and constant companion. There was many a day that Pauline would go to church and play the organ, and the moment church service was over, she would rush home because she could not leave her husband for a very long time. Peter finally passed away, and Pauline continued to live in Hawaii. We all remember that our dear Pauline developed lung cancer, and she had a very difficult last couple of years. When Pauline passed away, she left her estate to the church. That is the origin of the Gregg apartment. Every month we have monthly income from that apartment. She also gave her car to the church. She gave her furniture, her jewelry, her personal possessions to the Philoptohos to use for their fundraisers. She certainly was a very devoted and generous donor to this church. May their memories be eternal. There are two other donors that I would like to talk about. One is George Vavoulis. Many of you remember George. He didn't really attend our church until his wife had passed away, and then he decided to come back to Orthodoxy. At that time, he was in his late 70s. The women of the church would bake every Thursday. We would be making baklava and other pastries for the festival and for other fundraisers. George Favoulis and his stepson Don, who was in his 50s and had some social problems, I think he may have been autistic, would come every Thursday. And George immediately would make a beeline to the kitchen and he'd start washing pots and pans. Don would go into the baking room and talk to all the women that were in there, and they were all so good to him and all so patient to him. He especially loved Presbytera Ellie and Suzanne Akiona. You could usually find him right in between the two of them. Don had great ideas, like he wanted Presbytera Ellie, who had been a travel agent, to arrange a tour. And we would all be able to sign up, and we were going to go from professional baseball game to professional baseball game on a cruise ship, because those were his two great passions. George was always so thankful that the women were so nice to Don, and I think it gave him a few hours break. He knew that he was in a safe environment. We'd all sit down and have lunch together, and then we would continue working, and then they would go home. George and Don were both very ill. They both knew that their end was not far away, and they were each incredibly concerned about the other. George used to say, "What will happen to Don when I pass away?" Don would say, "What will happen to my dad when I pass away?" The son passed away, and George moved to California to live with a nephew. When he passed away, we were quite shocked to learn that he had left our church $127,000. All those years, we had heard these wonderful stories about how he had worked in the Coast Guard in World War II, a lot of war stories, and also how he had worked in oil exploration. What we didn't realize is that he was being paid partially in stock, and he was a very wealthy man at the end. He gave that terrific gift to our church, and I think a lot of it was because he was so grateful out of how well his stepson Don, was treated by the women. We used that gift to buy the photovoltaic system on the roof of our church that was just installed and just began running this year. This is truly a gift that keeps on giving. As you know, last year was very difficult for us. The last few years have been difficult for us. Last year, we ended the year $40,000 in the red. Our electric bill was $3,500 a month. This year, we're running approximately $450 a month because of that photovoltaic system. So God bless George Favoulis and his family. The last donor was Renau Constantino. I had really had hopes of being able to honor him in person this year, but he died just a few months ago. Renau was born on Cyprus, and he had joined the American Army. He traveled all over the world in Army service, and at one point he was stationed on Oahu, and his wife told him, "This is it. This is where we're going to live and retire." So they bought a home. He continued traveling. His wife and daughter stayed here, and he would come back. Finally, he retired from military service, and he started his own company. He started a company called Digitech. A lot of you remember it. It was an alarms company. When we acquired the church that we have now, Renau stepped forward and said, "I will put an alarm system on your church, and I will take care of it." He never charged us a dime for installation or for maintenance. To this day, we have never paid a bill for our alarm system on the church. When Renau sold the company to Alert Alarm many years ago, he wrote into the contract that they would continue to serve his home and our church. And we've been truly blessed by each and every one of these wonderful people. Thank you very much.
That was beautiful. That was beautiful. And I can't tell you how gratified I am to hear this great history of our church. And also, we should mention that, thanks to my wife, Ronnie, who woke me up this morning and said, we have to videotape this. So we have we're taping it, and if it's appropriate, we'll put it on YouTube and keep it, go in the time capsule. So generations from today will be able to hear this great and wonderful. How about another hand for what Regina did? It was just amazing. That was truly amazing. Thank you. We all didn't know the history of the church, but we all do now, and it's truly astounding. Next up, we have a speech by Father Dean Djigikos, who we all know was the first assigned priest to our church. Please join me in welcoming Father Dean. Thank you, Father.
One second. Grace Bishop Apostolo, my brothers in Christ of the Reverend Clergy and their presbyteris, and beloved faithful of St. Constantine and Helen Church. It's hard for me to comprehend that 47 years have passed since I first arrived in Honolulu to serve as the first pastor of this parish. When I was first ordained back in 1966, I was assigned to Waterloo, Iowa as my first parish. And a year later, I received word that Ted Anastasopoulos had been talking with some people in Boston, and my name came up. And I had received a call from the Archdiocese asking if I would be willing to come to Honolulu. We accepted, but it took a year for the actual transfer to take place. It was October of 1968 when Elaine and our son George were warmly welcomed at the airport with leis that were up to here and a very large teddy bear given to our son George from Tom and Rena Sofus. Harry Moskus was president of the parish council and the bureau chief of the Associated Press, and he managed to get a huge picture of us on the front page of the newspaper and continued to arrange publicity for the new parish on a continual basis, not only locally but nationally. I always tease him that you didn't have to put on the front page every time I sneezed. But the publicity was very beneficial for the parish, as we'll talk about here in a minute. Our welcome to Hawaii was dampened the third day that we were here, when someone pried open the lanai door of our hotel room and robbed us as we slept. In spite of that unfortunate incident, the warm aloha spirit prevailed, and our family felt very loved and very much at home during the 2 years that we were here. Services back then were held at the Epiphany Episcopal Church, and following their service, we quickly set up the altar, the icons, and the candle stand in order to celebrate the Divine Liturgy. The choir consisted of three people: my wife Elaine, Vicky Moskus, and Mary Kime, whose husband was in the military at that time. Mary played the organ, and the three of them consisted of the choir. Harry stood in the back welcoming people and watching the candles and also taking care of his two little daughters, Tina and Santi. Arnie Kime, Mary's husband, while she was playing the organ, sat with his two sons, Christopher and Mark, and our son, George, during the service. Arnie later constructed the first kuvuklion that we use for the Holy Friday services. God was truly at work making miracles happen back then, and let me share a few of them with you at this point. The first week we were here, a group of people invited Elaine and myself for dinner. And then they suggested that we go to the Outrigger Hotel, where a man by the name of Billy Dare was performing in the lounge. And the lounge was this huge place with a lot of people in it. And as we sat there listening to Billy play the piano and entertain the group, one of the people at our table sent a message to Billy that the new priest is here tonight. And when you have a break, come and meet him. Well, he didn't wait for the break. When he saw the note, he stopped in the middle of a song, and he goes, da 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 da. And he says, ladies and gentlemen, my new priest is here. We were kind of embarrassed. During his break, he then came over, and he took me over to a table to introduce me to the owner of the Outrigger Hotel, who was very kind and very cordial. He told me that if there was any way he could help the new parish, to feel free to call him. Well, several weeks later, I proposed to the parish council that we hold Epiphany service at the Waikiki Natatorium and throw the cross in the ocean. And I approached the owner of the Outrigger Hotel and asked him if he could make available a hotel banquet room where we could hold a fundraising dinner following the Epiphany services. He sat for not even 2 seconds, and he said, I'll not only make available a hall, but I'll prepare and donate all the food. So we had that first fundraiser. When we were going to do the Epiphany, my concern was weather, and everyone assured me it never rains in Waikiki. So we were at the natatorium celebrating divine liturgy, and in the middle of the service, the rain came. And with Harry's help with the newspaper on the front page of the newspaper the next day, Orthodox Christians celebrate the Epiphany, but it looks like they were baptized. In February of 1969, I was contacted by a real estate agent who wanted to show me a piece of property, and he thought the church would be interested in. It turned out that this real estate agent was the owner of the house that we bought, and he was the agent who sold it to us. So we had this little connection. And I explained to him that we weren't in any position to buy anything at this point. But he was very insistent and arranged to pick me up the very next day. He drove me to 17 Old Pally Place, just up the road here. He quoted me a price of $142,000 and asked if the facility would suit our needs. I told him the facility would fit the needs of the parish at that point, but again reiterated to him that we were in no financial position to do anything at that point. From there, instead of taking me back to home, he took me to a condo in Waikiki because he wanted me to meet the owner of the property. She was an elderly widow who had seen all the articles in the newspaper about me and about the Orthodox Church and thought perhaps the home that she and her husband had lived in would be suitable for us. I thanked her and told her that we were not financially able to do anything, and that $142,000 was way out of our reach. And when I said $142,000, she got this look on her face, and she looked at the realtor, and then she looked at me. She paused for a minute and said, could the church afford $71,000? I thought to myself, God is working a miracle again. I explained to both of them that that was not a decision that I could make, that I would have to meet with the parish council first. And several days later, the realtor met the parish council at 17 Old Pally Place. Everyone liked it, but the main objection was that it wasn't closer to town. But we finally agreed that it would be a good investment at that price of $71,000 on fee simple land, and that we could use it for a while, sell it, and then move closer to town. So on March the 17th in 1969, the General Assembly agreed. It was purchased with a $25,000 down payment consisting of donations from the faithful here as well as from many supporters in the mainland, and a loan of the amount of $46,000 was secured from the First Hawaiian Bank with the four signatures that Regina was talking about. I remember that day very well. I was at the bank with them, And the parking at the bank, you went up the ramp to park on the second or third floor. And when we got done signing, Arena Sofos was the treasurer at that time, we were coming down and she was in front of me. And she got to the man to pay the bill. And all of a sudden I see her get out of the car and she came running back to my car. And she says, "Do you have a dollar? I don't have any cash to pay for the pickers." True story. So I gave her a dollar so she could leave the parking lot. Donations were also received to buy liturgical items, chairs and organ and the office furniture. The icons that had been donated to the parish from the Boston Cathedral that was arranged from Ted Anastasopoulos when he was in Boston were installed in the church. But then we were faced with another obstacle. We could not hold services until we had off-street parking. There was plenty of land, but we needed $2,500 to do the paving. Many donated towards the paving, and several families made substantial donations, which made it possible to complete the paving. And I thought to myself, God's working in a miracle. On July 29th, in 1969, I received a letter from Archbishop Iakovos, in which he expressed his great joy at the progress that we were making, and that he was aware of the financial hardship that we were facing during that first year. And enclosed in his letter was a check from the Archdiocese in the amount of $5,000. And again, I thought to myself, God is working another miracle. With the parking lot completed and the interior of our church completed, finally on August the 24th in 1969, 10 months after my arrival, we stood on the porch of 17 Old Pally Place celebrating, celebrating an Ayismos, and George and Elizabeth Christofides offered the largest donation that morning that they have the honor of cutting the ribbon and to enter the church first. George was owned a taxi company and told me many stories of the war years. His wife Elizabeth was Hawaiian. After the opening of the church, I baptized Elizabeth, blessed their marriage, and baptized all their children and grandchildren. Elizabeth used to make leis. We had many visitors would come and visit, and I've treasured some things over the years, and I want to present them back to the parish. These are the leis that Elizabeth used to make, and when visitors would come, we would give them one of these leis. So that's the one thing. And that's how I, all these years, have remembered Elizabeth. So we all entered the church and celebrated the first services in the church that was finally ours. The parish continued to grow, and in addition to the Philoptikos, many other ministries were begun. Catechism classes, Greek school classes, Bible studies, vacation church school, Junior Goya and Goya. You might be interested to know that the first officers of Goya were Buddy Sofus, who was the president, Stephen Sofus, who was the vice president, Melanie Jula, who was the secretary, and Butch Bucus, who was the treasurer. And the first officers of the Junior Goya were Rhea Pyle, who was president, Cindy Proskephalus, who was the vice president, and George Pyle, who was the secretary. Back then, we had many small fundraisers and several very large major fundraisers. The first was the Epiphany dinner dance at the Outrigger Hotel that I mentioned earlier. The second was on January the 25th in 1969. We held a gala fashion show entitled Flight into Fashion at the Ilikai Hotel that was sponsored by Delta Airlines. Each of the 1,000 people in attendance received, and this is something else I've kept all these years, received one of these. The ladies had made 1,000 of these, okay? and they were filled with little samples of perfume and anything they could collect from all the vendors down in Waikiki. In addition to the small items that they had placed in these little bag of take-home packages, they had collected over 200 door prizes through the efforts of people like Rena Sophus and Fanny Prescephalus and some of the other ladies of the parish. As I mentioned, there were 1,000 people that attended this event. 997 of them were women. 3 of them were men. The 3 men that were there was the governor of Hawaii, myself, and Billy Dare, who played the piano and entertained us during the fashion show and the dinner and so on and so forth. Every once in a while, they would stop. They would hold up a prize and then pull a name out to give away one of those 200 prizes. And this went on during the entire program. Well, they held up a bottle of Meissen perfume and acknowledged the donor, one of the vendors down in Waikiki. They reached in and pulled out a name, and with much laughter, the winner of Meissen perfume is Father Dean. On May the 4th, in 1969, we held a bake sale at the International Marketplace. That was very interesting. The ladies were working one day at Nick's Fish Market, using their kitchen the day they were closed to bake. And then on another day in the week, they would meet at the Outrigger Canoe Club that Peter Van Dorn was managing at the time and use their kitchen. And they were baking all these things, but we had nowhere to hold the bake sale. And I told the ladies, I said, why don't we go down to the International Marketplace? In those years, it was the place to be. And they all looked at me like I was crazy, like they're not going to let us go there. So I went down, I talked to the general manager and explained to him who I was. And he says, oh, I've seen your picture in the newspaper and I've read about all the things at the church. He says, what can I do to help? I said, well, we're going to have a bake sale, and you have this beautiful grassy area in the middle of the International Marketplace. Can we come down and set some tables and sell the wares? He says, no, you can't do that. He said, it's not permitted. I said, well, what can we do? He says, well, I don't know. I said, well, it's an international thing. You don't have anything Greek here. I said, how about if we set up a display of Greek articles and icons and so on and so forth? He says, you can do that. And I said, and can we put a small table off to the side and sell the pastries? So he finally agreed after much to do. And when he said, okay, I said, I need it in writing. So the poor guy had his secretary type me a letter. And I went back to Nick's Fish Market where the ladies were baking that day. And I said, you all were wrong. I said, we do have a place. We're going to the International Marketplace. And indeed we did. And that was the first bake sale that we had, but it wasn't over then. Just a few days before the event, I got a call from some city official, and they said, we understand you're having a bake sale at the International Marketplace. I said, yes. He said, well, you have to have peddler license. I said, okay, what is that involved? He says, well, you need to come down and get some forms and have the people fill them out, and it's gonna cost, I think it was $10 per person to get this peddler license. So I thought, okay, what do you do? So I went down and he said, do you have any senior citizens, I said, that are going to be selling? I said, yes, why? He says, well, the peddler license for seniors is no charge. So I said, well, give me some for both. So I went and I told the ladies, I said, you know, only the senior citizens are going to sign up on this. So we had a stack of senior citizen forms. I took them back down and he looked through them. He said, well, how about the ones of the younger people? I said, they're not going to be there. It's just the senior citizens that are going to be there. Well, he said, well, it's not necessary then because it's going to be a lot of work for him. And he said, not necessary. I said, no, I don't want to have any problems. So I made him fill out the forms and got these peddler license for them. So we had that first successful bake sale at the International Marketplace. The other major fundraiser was a Greek night. Louis Gundunas came from California with his band at no charge to the parish. He provided music for dancing, and then he entertained us with a magnificent performance of dancing with a table between his teeth with someone sitting on it, if some of you were there remember. It was a performance that he had done in the Broadway production of Zorba the Greek. So he came and did that for us. When I was transferred, the last box was being carried out of our house by the mover, and the phone rang, and it was the Western Union office. No emails and things back in those days. And I said, read the telegram to me. We had reservations to leave a couple of days later to go back to the mainland. And it was from the Archdiocese, and it said, Archbishop Makarios of Cyprus is visiting Honolulu in 10 days, and we want you to remain to receive him on our behalf. So we remained another 2 weeks in order to receive Archbishop Makarios of Cyprus. It was a very interesting experience for me personally, being with the military people and all the officials of Cyprus at that time. We've made our first visit back to Honolulu and attended the Divine Liturgy at the church at 17 Old Pali Place. On the last day that the liturgy was going to be celebrated before you moved down to your new facility. So to celebrate the Divine Liturgy at 17 Old Pali Place, the very first time, and to be there for the very last time, for me was another miracle. I could go on and on with stories about events that happened during those Vietnam years, and about the miracles of this parish. We all know that God's blessing did not stop in October of 1970 when Elaine and I left the islands. God has continued to bless this parish over the years with outstanding clergy, with lay leaders and benefactors that have made possible the beautiful house of worship that you now enjoy. I would like to take just a moment more to thank some of the individuals that worked so hard those first 2 years when I had the pleasure to serve here. I could easily talk an hour about each one of them and about the special contribution of time and talent and treasure that they made. Some have fallen asleep to the Lord, others no longer live here, but they all have one thing in common. They laid the foundation of this parish. When Regina had contacted us and told us about the anniversary, I started going through some old papers and I found the bulletins. I made copies of the bulletins of the 2 years I was here and sent to Regina for the files, along with some newspaper articles and pictures and things that would hopefully serve to help with the celebration. And I was looking over the weekly parish bulletins. I found that on November the 24th, 1968, a month after I had arrived here, we had a general assembly, and there were 35 people in good standing at that general assembly. In alphabetic order, there are Ted Anastasopoulos, George and Catherine Bukas, Kula and Charles Barrow, Elizabeth and George Christofides, Aphrodite and James Cronus, George Cronus, Anna and Serge Dankovich, Dimitri Gassis, Arati Geisler, Mary and Arnie Kime, Nick Lycurgus, Elena and Michael Michalidis, Vicky and Harry Moskis, Ann and Peter Palacios, Fanny Paul, Fanny and Peter Proskephalos, Catherine Costa Romanus, Tonda and Larry Sharoma, Elias Schurer, Rena and Tom Sofus, Mr. and Mrs. Harry Zakas. Those were the 35 people that were families that were present at that first General Assembly. 9 months later, when we began holding services at 17 Old Pali Place, the number grew from 35 to 69 in good standing. And the additional 34 people at that point, according to the parish bulletins, were Julia Nasasopoulos and Mr. and Mrs. James Bird, Tanya and Walter Burakin, Billy Dare, Mr. and Mrs. Marshall Derby, Zoe Hensley, Helen Hunt, John Johnson, Mr. and Mrs. Paul Jula, Captain Ernie Kachikas, Mr. and Mrs. Anatoly Oven, Marianne McGuire, Maria Mulas, Nick Nicholas, Steve Polanski, Peter and John Pyle, Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Riffle, Martha Salidas, Catherine Sedaris, Helen Stickle, Kiki and Ted Theodoro, Dr. and Mrs. Demetrius Tsoulas, Pauline and Peter Van Dorn, and Louis Siguyanis. And after that, the parish continued to grow. These 69 people representing 44 families laid the foundation upon which this parish has been built. Together we prayed, together we worked, together we built to the glory of God. And my sincere thanks to each and every one of them and to their families for sharing their time and their talent and their treasures in helping establish the parish. During the time that I served her, the name of the church was simply the Eastern Orthodox Church. And later it became the Greek Orthodox Church. And years later it was named St. Constantine and Helen. Constantine in memory of Constantine Romanis, and Helen in memory of Tom Sophus's mother, Helen. Is it a coincidence, perhaps another miracle, that the church that Elaine and I established took the name of our patron saints, Saints Constantine and Helen? On this, the 40th anniversary of the parish, Elaine and I would like to present to the parish something that we've enjoyed for nearly 50 years. It was given to us, and I think it belongs back here in Honolulu. It's a very interesting icon, but what makes it special is what's written on the back. This is the historical part. It says, to Rena Sophus, good luck as the first president of the women of the Eastern Orthodox Church of Honolulu, December 29th, 1967. It was given by Lee Borelli. Lee was a friend of Rena's from San Francisco. And the next inscription says, to Father Dean Jijikas, our first Greek Orthodox priest of Hawaii, Rena Sophus. And the third inscription, St. Constantine and Helen and Cathedral, in honor of the 50th anniversary from your first priest, Father Dean. Let me close with excerpts from King Solomon's prayer, which he spoke upon the dedication of the temple in Jerusalem. It's recorded in 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 28 and chapter 8, verse 52. It was his prayer so many centuries ago, and it's my prayer today for this parish celebrating its 50th anniversary, of which I was blessed to have been its first priest. King Solomon prayed, Lord God, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth below. You keep your covenant with your people and show them your love when they live in obedience to you. Listen to my prayer and grant the request that I make to you today. Watch over this temple day and night. Hear my prayer and the prayers of your people when they come to this place to pray. And if any of your people stretch out their hands in prayer in this temple, hear their prayer, listen to them, forgive them, and help them. Solomon said this prayer and this is also my prayer for you. May you, his people, always be faithful to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, obeying all his laws and all his commands. May God bless you with not 50 more years, but hundreds of years of the future of this parish. Mahalo.
I think it's appropriate these gifts should not stay here, so I'd like to ask our parish president, Maria Naval, and also our 50th anniversary, Regina Mass, could please come forward so we could have a photograph and formally pass these gifts over to the two of you. I think it's appropriate. It's our precious gifts. To our parish council president. It's an incredible history to kind of hear these stories again and get these wonderful gifts that he's... And thank you so much, Father Dean, for so much for keeping these great, what a wonderful historical artifacts that we have. Truly, it's amazing. You know, as I'm hearing all these things, I know that you're feeling the same way, but I am totally inspired by nothing less than acts of heroism, the heroics that it took to found this church, to bring it here, and to grow it here. It is an incredible foundation, and we, as the next generation of members of Saints Helen and Constantine Greek Orthodox Cathedral of the Pacific, we owe it to our founders, we owe it to essentially our spiritual ancestors to carry on and grow this parish in their honor. We owe it to them. We have a duty to do that. So I want you all to kind of be thinking about that. We have some more stories that we're going to be hearing, and I want to hear about all those great headlines that went on and what was all behind that, being a media guy myself. So next up, please join me in welcoming Mr. Harry Moskos, one of the founders of our church.
Your Grace, your clergy, I want to say congratulations to everybody here. This is a very touching day. I got tears, not allergies, but it's. We were also blessed with another miracle, Archbishop Iacobos. Two visits to Honolulu, and by coincidence with my and Vicky's arrival here and some previous contact within the Orthodox Church, as ironic too that we came here from Albuquerque with the close friends with the Dogeses later. But Iacobos came through the airport. Several of us from the community went to greet him. I will not mention names, but one family said, "You're not going to ask him to do a service." I said, "Yes, we are." And he immediately agreed. And then within a year, I think there was a second visit with Father Bokopoulos, the chancellor, who happened to be with him. Both trips were en route to Japan. But it was with his guidance, his leadership, his skill, that this thing came about. He first got the Air Force to send chaplains on a periodic basis. Father Peter Zanalovich would come out here on not on a regular basis. He was not assigned here. And then they got Father Stroyan to be assigned to Hickam Air Force Base with the agreement that the Archbishop worked with the Air Force. You give us a chaplain for one tour of duty, we promise to take over with a civilian priest. So it took the people here and the guidance from Archbishop Iacobos and, of course, from our Lord, that all this gelled together into one great effort. And then prior to Father Stroyan, as pointed out, Father Ballam came out from Los Angeles for the Holy Days. So we were able to get the church growing. But it's interesting, I think some of you have heard this. We arrive in town and you look in the phone book, look under churches, there's no Orthodox church, no Greek, no Antiochian, no OCA. I said, "Well, you gotta look for Greek names." I flip open the phone book. I see Pappas, P-A-P-A-S. I said, "There's a whole bunch of, there's Greeks all over the place." I call the first one. He says, "Oh no, Pappas with one P is
Filipino. But anyway, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to be here and to wish you continued success and to thank you very, very, very much. And this is just feels so great to see the accomplishments of so many people with so many different ethnic backgrounds, but Orthodoxy prevails. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Harry. That's wonderful. You know, before we continue, I want just a housekeeping message here. It's last call, so if you have a drink ticket, make sure you cash it in. And you need to go to the bar if you want to get your drink, because the bar is closing. We're coming near the end of our program here, and I'd like you all to join me for our next speaker. Please rise in joining me to welcome His Grace Bishop Apostolos.
Thank you. Aloha. I was thinking about the people that don't know exactly the Orthodoxy, and when they're visiting the Orthodox Church, the first sign that they receive is the long service. But how about to invite non-Orthodox people to the long luncheon? This is the Greek way, but we love it, right? I wanted to say something that perhaps the historian didn't mention to his history about who found the islands here, Captain Koo. And who was the co-captain? Was a Greek fellow, was it? Do you believe that? Or who was his cook? I believe that. Anyway, I think it's a wonderful day that we gather in this beautiful, beautiful place in order to offer to our Lord Jesus Christ a warm thanksgiving for everything that He has been giving to you, to this beautiful community in Honolulu. I was listening carefully. The beautiful lady, the church lady who spoke very nicely about the history of the church, and I thank you so much. Father Dean as well, and the wonderful young gentleman who spoke about the history of our beautiful and blessed memory, Archbishop Iacobus. And I was telling to myself, what do we have in our hand today? What is the responsibility? What is the obligations, the commitments that we do have today, the young generation, in order to sustain this legacy and give it to our children and grandchildren? These people, they came to these beautiful islands for nothing, and they built a wonderful church, wonderful community, family. Because you are a wonderful family in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Wonderful family. An example of archdiocese. And you make the achievement through your faith. And you open the door to each of the Orthodox people and non-Orthodox people to join the Greek Orthodox faith in Honolulu Island and at large in the Hawaii state. I've been serving to this diocese, Metropolis of San Francisco, the last 4 years. And this is my third time that I've been coming and visiting you. And I'm very proud of you. I'm very proud because you're authentic missionaries of Christ, our God. You receive the gospel by your parents, grandparents. And you're trying to be the apostles and the disciples of our Lord Jesus Christ in this beautiful land, islands, state of Hawaii. and you make the wonderful deal with God. With through your faith and dedication to our faith, to our church, our archdiocese, metropolis, you did the miracle that Father Dean has mentioned this morning many times. And this is indeed what exactly God wanted. Nothing could be happen if God didn't want it. You should believe that. God wanted, and you make it. He used you for his labor. He sent the appropriate priest to serve you. He sent the appropriate and wonderful leaders like Archbishop Iakovos, Metropolitan Anthony, Bishop Meletios, Bishop Anthimos, Metropolitan Gerasimos. Wonderful hierarchs of the church and dedicated wonderful clergymen with their own families. And you did the miracle because that wanted by God. And God is very proud of you today. You should think about it. And you should think that you are so blessed. Very blessed. Because this is where exactly God wanted. And you took the seeds from the gospel and you planted to this beautiful island. And today it's a wonderful tree giving fruits to the people. Giving what exactly the people they really need in order to be connected with God. The spiritual food, the protection by God, the shelter by his protection and his guidance. He established a wonderful family, community, Paris. And he opened the door to give the message to each of the nation that has been living to this island, that the Greek Orthodox faith belongs to everyone. It's not only for the Greek heritage or the people who was born in Greece, but belongs to the people who really want to be connected with God, to believe that Christ is the only begotten Son whom offered his life on the cross for salvation, for peace, for conquered. This is what exactly we need to proclaim through our life, believing as a good member, a parishioner to St. Constantine and Helen Church Cathedral at the Pacific Ocean. I was born and raised in Greece, in a beautiful island, and I would love to living with you in a beautiful island here. I've never thought that I would be a young bishop offering a speech at the beautiful event and a milestone that you've been celebrating today. And I'm very proud of you. And I'm very inspired. And I'm very, I can say, a bishop with hope. A bishop with great horizon that I can be able to see the future of this cathedral along with your beautiful dedication and effort that you've been giving every day to your church. I know that sometimes we feel desperate. We feel alone, far away from the mainland, but this has not happened to you. I think you have already been realized because you are under the protection of God. And if you've seen the grow just in the 50 years, what exactly happened to your community here? And I was listening to the history, just few people. And you bought the church, and you found the founders, donors, you found the priests. And I was thinking about the years of the apostles. Just 12 people. They transformed the whole universe. They illumined the whole world by the Spirit of God. You have done the same thing. You are the yeast of the faith. And you put in here to the holy bread of God, and you multiply the bread of God to the whole congregation here. I'm very moved because I've never thought in my life, been living in Greece, that these wonderful people exist on earth. Your faith is amazing. Your dedication. It's a wonderful element that you've been carrying in your heart, in your minds. And you exactly reminds me what exactly the gospel says. You should love your God with your whole heart, your mind, and your soul. You have done that. And also, another piece of the gospel saying, I'm going to read it first in Greek, which is the authentic language of the gospel. Matthew 13:37. Spiron to kalon, sperma estin. The one who sows the good seed. There's another beautiful ministry that you have been doing to this wonderful community. I couldn't be able to speak to you many, many minutes, but I think it's appropriate to recognize and say that your achievement is unique in our archdiocese and metropolis of San Francisco. And I would like to congratulate on behalf of His Eminence, Metropolitan Hierosimus, to whom I represent today, all of you, each of you. And I'm very proud that the previous speaker spoke about the founders and the people who really work for the labor of Christ and today are not with us. And tomorrow at the Holy Hierarchical Liturgy, we're going to offer a special memorial service, commemorating and praying for the souls of those people who've fallen asleep on the Lord. And also, tomorrow, we're going to present doxology to give thanks to our Lord Jesus Christ for this wonderful milestone, the 50 years anniversary that we celebrated today. Giving thanks to Him and say, thank you, Lord, for everything that you've been giving to us in our life, including our bishops, our parents, grandparents, clergy, and children. Yesterday, I was telling a story that happened to me when I was visiting a community in Los Angeles area. A young man was in the altar, and he saw me holding the hierarchical staff, and he didn't know what exactly I was it. And he says to me, can I ask you something, sir? I said, yes. Are you Leonidas? I said, who Leonidas? You know Leonidas, the 300 for Sparta? I said, no, I'm not Leonidas, but I'm a bishop of the church. And this young man didn't know what exactly bishop means. And I felt so bad as a new bishop on the church. And I wanted to apologize to those people that perhaps we missed something in our ministry. And we need to start in doing something to educate correctly, to give the good food to the people, the blessed fruits from the gospel. And I wanted to say I'm sorry if we couldn't be able to come and see you the last 50 years, to see you, your families, how are you doing here? What exactly you need far away from the mainland? But as I said in the beginning, you're always protected by God. You should believe that. At the same time, you are the people that you can be able to multiply Christianity, faith, the truly faith of Orthodox people the gospel of God to these state of the United States. And I'm asking you, through my faith, my life, please continuously do so. And I wanted to ask you to keep your young people connected with your community. Not to stay away because of some many circumstances, perhaps. The young people, they don't understand. We understand, and we need to give to them the knowledge and the seed of faith. Don't forget, everybody in this room received faith through our home first. Katikon Ecclesia, the church and home. This is the most important. You give in the seed, and we give in the water. We give in the earth, but you need to give the seed. And then we're going to take care of the plan to be grow, give fruits to the people. This is your commitment as parents and grandparents. Don't forget to give that wonderful faith to your kids. Do your cross first when you're eating. It's a wonderful sign. Sometimes we're concerned about our faith, and at the same time we're concerned about families. Why the kids are not coming to the church? How many times the parents going to the church every Sunday? How many parents they doing prayer every morning or every night before bed? Don't forget the kids. Overseeing the parents and grandparents. Whatever you're going to do, they're going to follow you. They copy you. And I'm telling you with my heart, because this is what we need to do in order to keep our children connected with the family and the same time the family home, which is our church. And don't forget, as long as we're connected with the church, we are protected. We are safe. That's why we're being blessed and growing in faith. Without the presence of Christ and church in our town, we are completely desperate and open to every danger to be attacked in our life. See the reality. What happened recently to Oregon? Who knows what exactly is going to happen tomorrow, the next day of tomorrow? We don't know. Only God knows. That's why we need his protection. I'm giving you my blessings as a new bishop of the church. Continuously praying in your home. Support your community. Support the youth ministry of your community as you've been doing, and I thank you. Because you've been bringing the youth to the FDF program, the Metropolis San Francisco. Choir. Goya program. Sunday school program. This is the necessity and the very important ministries of the church, the parish, the family. Keep this in your mind, that a young bishop visited your island and told you these little things with my heart, because I believe these things. I also wanted to share with you a wonderful letter the Metropolitan Gerasimos asked me to read to you, and also to give a wonderful certificate to the parish council president and also to the parish priest for the wonderful milestone that we've been celebrating today. Allow me to read his letter. And I thank him very much who gave me this opportunity to come and represent him in this beautiful event of the wonderful Cathedral Church here in St. Constantine and Helen in the Pacific Ocean. Reverend Father Alex Leon, esteemed and faithful stewards, St. Constantine and Helen Greek Orthodox Cathedral, Honolulu. Dearest Father Alex and beloved brothers and sisters in the Lord, let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to serve, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Timothy 6:18. This passage from St. Paul's letter to Timothy expresses my most sincere thoughts as we are celebrating the 50 years of existence. Under the loving care of God, our beloved Cathedral of the Pacific Greek Orthodox Church of Saints Constantine and Helen surely deserves many accolades and even more wishes and prayers. This I send to you since another important event of pastoral nature kept me from doing so in person. These past 50 years have been a time of faith and growth for your parish, as you have provided for the spiritual, educational, and social needs for many generations of Orthodox Christians in Hawaii. You are your second home as a result of things' growth, and you are now one of the most ethnically diverse communities in the Archdiocese. Celebrate your uniqueness and be proud of your accomplishments. Look to the future and create a vision out of abundant faith. Move forward as a community with a unity of belief, knowing that the Lord will guide and bless you each step of the way. Always be mindful of the special ministry God has called you to the residents and visitors of Hawaii. I sincerely congratulate all who have labored for this weekend. Your priest, Father Alex, your president, Maria Criticos Nava, your chairperson, Regina Mas, and reservation chair, Christina Dimitrion, and your parish council in making it a most memorable celebration in the life of your community. I also express my gratitude to the founders of this community and all previous clergy and faithful who prayed, who played a role in building up the community to the vibrant house of God in this today. May the abundant blessings of the Lord be upon you always, and may His light illumine your path so that all things will be for the glory of God. With love in Christ, His Eminence Metropolitan Hierasimos of San Francisco. I would like to ask Father Alex, the Parish Council President, the Chair Lady, to come forth.
And also the Master of Ceremony, he have done a wonderful job. Did he? Please read it.
I read this to you. 50-year celebration of a milestone. Saints Constantine and Helen Greek Orthodox Cathedral, Honolulu, Hawaii. On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Matthew 16:18. May the Lord continue to bless your beloved community for the next 50 years and beyond as you bring praise, glory, and honor to His holy name. With love in Christ, October 3rd, 2015, Metropolitan Hierasimos of San Francisco.
Bravo. Closing my speech today, I would like to thank all of you again for this wonderful labor of Christ that you've been doing. Again, congratulations to the Chair Lady, Master of Ceremony, Father Alexandros, and Parish Council President and the whole Parish Council people, the Philoptical Society, for everything that you've been offering to the church and your dedication to the church. And beyond of that, you, the wonderful and faithful people of St. Constantine and Helen, the Cathedral, and also the benefactors and all the wonderful people that work the last 50 years in order this beautiful cathedral be the beacon of the Orthodox faith in the Pacific Ocean. Thank you again, and mahalo. I'm looking forward to see you tomorrow at the Holy Liturgy. And of course, tonight, I don't know how many of you can come enjoy it, the Greek Lendi. All right? Χρόνια πολλά σε όλους και ο Θεός μαζί σας. Να έχετε υγεία.
Thank you, Your Grace. You know, I enjoyed your remark about the fact that we could withstand a long lunch. And what I want to add to that is, είμαστε Orthodoxy. We are Orthodox. Not only could we withstand that lunch, but if we wanted to, we could do it standing up. Before we close with the invocation, we wanted to give away the table settings. So the table settings, there is under each chair, there's a sticker. And if there's a number 50 on your chair, the table setting is yours. So you can hunt for that. And while you're hunting for that, we're gonna have the invocation. So Father, do you want all the clergy to come forward? Yes, how about if all the clergy come forward?
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages, amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Master, give the blessing.
Χριστέ ο Θεός ημών, ευλόγησον τα περισσέματα της τραπέζης ταύτης και πλήθυνον αυτά εν της οίκης των συνδετημόνων ταύτης και το κόσμο σου άπαντε ότι Άγιος υπάνονται νυν και αεί και εις τους αιώνας των αιώνων. Αμήν. Christ our God, bless the remains of this table and multiply in this wonderful cathedral, and to the parishioners and the visitors and good friends in this parish, now and forever, and to the ages of ages. Amen. Χρόνια πολλά, many, many years to you, and may God give us the good health to be again in this room to celebrate 100th anniversary.